Preparation eliminates fear. And once you've eliminated fear, you've got less anxiety. Coaches have three responsibilities. One is to respect the game of the past, because the game of the past has its own lessons that you can take out. Two is to vigorously and extensively study the game of the present. And three is to anticipate the game of the future. But all those things cannot be done if you are not exposed to a global space of where the game is. We always say that love them before you coach them. Connect with them before you correct them.
Hello, captains of Armband. Welcome to the third episode of Short Corners, where we interview footballers, coaches, managers, scouts, directors, and owners of various football clubs and bring the different aspects of the game closer to you. Today, along with us, we have Mr. Rulani Mokwena, who is the head coach of Mamelodi Sundowns. So, Mr. Rulani, how are you doing?
Very well, Meghna, very well. Thank you for having me, and good evening to the Armband viewers and to everybody in India. It's fantastic to speak to people in a different continent and touch base. I see there's a lot of very good things happening in your country with regards to football, and it's good to be in touch with you guys.
I'm sure the viewers are also happy to have you with us today. Yesterday, you had the semi-final second leg match and your team won by 4-1 on aggregate. So you're now into the finals. How are you feeling about it? Are you excited?
Oh, yeah, we're excited. Our first cup final as the coaches of the team. And we're in a very good moment. So we're just looking forward to preparing now for a very difficult match on Saturday against Morocco Swallows. And then we have the FIFA break, and the final is still something way off next month for us to even start thinking about it now.
That's great. So without further ado, let's begin our podcast session. You come from a family where your grandfather, Eric Sono, is an Orlando Pirates legend. Both your father, Julius Sono, and your uncle, Jomo Sono, were professional footballers. You also started your career as a player coach at the age of 14. In one of your previous podcasts, you mentioned that since that young age, you started to demand a lot from yourself and became your worst critic. How did that resolve shape the early part of your career and also your life in general as a teenager?
The good thing was I started my coaching very, very young. That allowed me to take a lot of lessons while I was starting and gain a lot of experience with regards to being on the pitch. And then, of course, before even the age of 24, I had already consumed more than 10,000 hours of football on the pitch, of training, of coaching, and then of course you move into a very difficult space, because at that age, when everybody else is enjoying their teens and their early 20s, I was making sacrifices for the game. I was coaching when people were partying. I was setting up training sessions when everybody else had a nice social time. When everybody was sleeping, I was working, you know. And from a very early part of my career, I was used to investing and putting a lot of hours into the sport. And that's helped me a lot, because today I'm able to do quite a number of things that relate and inform performance, including the conditioning aspects, including match analysis aspects, including mentoring and overall influence with regards to training, nutrition, the managerial side of the game. Because when you start coaching in the amateur ranks, you are everything. You're the driver, you're the team manager, you're the coach, you're the physio. So you learn a little bit about everything that informs performance. And I was only fortunate enough to be able to be put in a space like that, where I was just doing the best that I could for the game.
That's a lot of hard work and dedication. And now you're here today. In 2014, yeah, at Mamelodi Sundowns, you were promoted to be one of the assistant managers of the head coach, Pitso Mosimane. In 2017, you joined Orlando Pirates as the assistant manager to Milutin Sredojević. Each of these head coaches was from different nations, cultures, and backgrounds. And each of them had their own beliefs, style, and philosophy. So, how did your role as an assistant manager change during these phases? And what were your key takeaways from these jobs?
It's a good question. Pitso Mosimane was fantastic for me. I learned so much from him, not necessarily about the pitch, but more about the off-the-field management, managing the upward management, as we call it, in terms of managing the office, managing the colleagues and managing the support staff and even the players and trying to get the best out of the players. The winning mentality also was something that Coach Pitso was very strong with. But also on the pitch, he was very good. But I always say that in that moment, you have to be the assistant that the team needs or the coach that the team needs. I had a very strong coach in relation to demanding from the players when I was at Mamelodi Sundowns first stint. And Coach Pitso was extremely aggressive with regards to the pressure that he put on the players. And I had to be a little bit more subtle and supportive and more of the good cop. But also try to support as much as I could with regards to training and preparation of the team on the pitch. But when I moved to Pirates, the role was a lot similar, but with a little bit more pressure because we had a different coach in Milutin, Sredojević, who came in and was someone that worked very hard, but also was good with relations with the players, but more of the good cop. And when I was at Pirates with Milutin, I ended up having to do a little bit more of the demanding and putting a lot more pressure on the players. And I tried to be the coach that I felt that the head coach needed. And that's always my take, even now as a coach. My beliefs is try to be the coach that you feel the team needs.
You believe that football is a microscopic reflection of society, and a lot of what we find in the society can also be found in football. Now, that's also true for the footballers and the individuals associated with the game. So, what are the character traits and qualities that you look for in a footballer while scouting talents and developing them?
It's a broad question because, I mean, the first part of your question addresses the social economical sort of situation where I always speak about football being a microscopic reflection of society. And by that, I mean that everything that happens in society happens in football. And apart from that, football is just part of the global society. Football is just part of the holistic view of what is happening globally in relation to some of the challenges. So if we have leadership situations or challenges in society, we are going to face the same in football. And exactly that is how do we then transfer this professional athlete that everybody views in a more of a celebratory role with a status of being famous and above everybody else with regards to society and the communities. But we always preach about the importance of a very good lifestyle, very good social skills, and very good character, you know, and those are the things that we also still look for, apart from the technical aspects, where, you know, you've still got to be a very good footballer. You still have to have the technical skills to be able to perform on the pitch. But the reality for us is, if you look at it, within 24 hours, you only spend maybe 2, 3, 4 hours on the football pitch or in the football community. And for the rest of the 24 hours, you are integrated back into society. And then it becomes very important to be good members in society, to be good role models, and to give as much as we can to society and to the next generation. And that is a responsibility that a lot of footballers now have, which is challenging because not only do we have, as I said, the challenges from a social perspective with regards to the perspective and the lenses that they use to view football players. But the reality also is that they are human beings as well, and they have the same sort of pressures as the general human person in within the community. So, and apart from that, then you've got the advancement of society, the importance of social media and the challenges that come with social media and the pressures that come with the performances on social media. And you can see already the influence that has on football players. So that's why it is so important to first and foremost be a good human being, be a good person. Because we believe that good human beings, good human skills allow for the creation of good football players.
If you are not a good human being, then you cannot be a good role model. I think that's why your words are true.
Yeah, of course, Meghna. And that's so important. In football, there's the perception that the people involved in the game are robotic and have no feelings and emotions. But the reality is they are just human beings, and human beings that have, as I said, the same sort of social ills as the average human being, the same sort of social challenges, the same sort of psychological pressures with regards to anxiety and stress and insecurities. And that is why, as coaches now, the most successful coaches in the world are coaches that are human driven. They understand that first and foremost, before working with athletes, you are working with human beings. So it is a philosophy or a way of working that is athlete centered, the human centered perspective, you know. And that's the most important thing, because when you want to correct, it becomes very difficult if you haven't made the connection. So we always say that love them before you coach them, connect with them before you correct them. And that makes it a lot easier for you to be able to get the best out of the person.
Coming to Mamelodi Sundowns, in the past 2 years, Sundowns have reduced the average age of the squad and have also made the squad more versatile. But bringing in more players is not enough. As a head coach, you also need to make the existing player feel important and needed. With the long-serving captain, Mokwena, leaving the club and a lot of young players arriving, how do you plan to keep this new set of players indulged in your idea and culture season after season?
Yeah, it's not easy. It's not easy, but the culture that has been created in Mamelodi Sundowns allows for this relentless drive, this relentless desire to succeed. It's a culture that has been set on a working culture where there's extremely high levels of demands with regards to the work ethic that is demanded in our environment. High performance environments are exactly like this, where we understand that you're only as good as your previous performances, and you've got the responsibilities to make sure that not only do you maintain the high levels of success and the ability to perform week in, week out, but you're only as good as your previous performances, because high stress, high demands put you in a position where you can't even regress, because once you regress, you understand that everybody else is coming behind you and wants to try to catch up. So we work very hard, not just from the psychological perspective, but also from the demands that we put in the training sessions to make training even more difficult than matches. While you work on all these things, you also embrace and encourage the players to be extremely competitive with their mentality, and that allows you to move in that space where you are. It's easier to maintain the success of the team and the squad. So, of course, the first is to make sure that you set a tactical culture, certain game principles that are easy to evaluate, correct, analyze. These are the aspects that allow for consistency, and they lay the foundation. But of course, it's then the quality of the players, because the game belongs to the players. And by quality of the players, it's not just the technical aspects. It's also the psychological aspects, the relentless drive from the players to want more, to never be satisfied in trying to make sure that we always raise the bar each and every single time with regards to our performances.
In an interview, Jose Mourinho said that preparing a team well, tactically and physically, requires high intensity work. But it's difficult to put in that sort of high intensity work if there is fixture congestion. In one of your previous podcasts, you also mentioned that building match condition and fitness require time and a continuous psychological engagement. During a run of congested fixtures, how do you prepare the team for the upcoming matches and also keep the players mentally fresh and physically fit?
It's a very good question once again, but of course, for a lot of the work that we do, we are process driven. We are guided by where we are with regards to where we want the team to be, from not just from a technical, tactical, or maybe even from a physical perspective, but also from a psychological perspective, the goals and the objectives that we set for ourselves, the performance parameters that are in place, and of course, what we call KPIs, which are key performance indicators. These are the things that allow for us to be able to not just set certain performance standards, but also maintain and continuously evaluate these standards. And that's the space that we are in. We are in a space where performance is at the highest level is the most important. The psychological engagement in, in regards to stimulating performance is very important. And then you've got to ask yourself, how do you then stimulate from a psychological perspective? The level of motivation is important, and the level of motivation speaks to you about not just the intrinsic motivation, which is the desire to be better, and that you can't buy, that you can't go into the transfer market for. That must be within that scope when you profile athletes and you profile football players. That is a quality that they must possess, of course, and that at the highest level, you see the biggest difference is psychological. But that intrinsic motivation still needs to be supported by the extrinsic motivation, which is the team goals, the team objectives, and also the money, the fame, et cetera, et cetera. These are the things that come into that space. But these are just byproducts of the performance demands and the standards of the team that sets for the group. And once you have those, you are then looking to find some form of stimulation from the technical aspects, making sure that there's a lot of fun in an environment, making sure that the environment is conducive for growth, making sure that the environment also is an environment that allows the players to learn and work every single day to not just train, but train to get better, train to improve, and train to win. And that's the most important thing. And once you can find these stimuli and stimulate some form of not just cognitive growth from a psychological perspective, that allows also for better tactical application and better decision-making. But you also work in relation to the technical development of the players, improving them from different technical aspects and working to make sure that all of this contributes to the overall performance of the team.
A quick shout out to our merchandise partner, Midfield Merchandise. If you want to buy quality 100% cotton t-shirts, stickers and lapel pins at affordable prices, Midfield Merchandise is the place to visit. Upon applying this coupon code, you will get a special 30% discount on your purchases. The link to the site and the coupon code are also given in the description below.
Coming to pre-match preparations, before a match, as a head coach, you can prepare your players and make them aware of the possibilities and challenges the opposition team may throw at them. Still, there will often be scenarios that the players will never be fully prepared for, such as the opposition player's quality and ability to make quick, intuitive decisions and a completely unexpected tactical structure from the opposition side. How do you prepare your players for these situations where they have to think and act on their own?
Fantastic question. The game is moved into such a space where there's a lot more chaos on the pitch, and the teams that are able to manage that chaos, the team that is able to come up with better dynamic solutions during the 90 minutes is obviously the team that has a better chance to win football matches. Of course, there's other aspects and factors that contribute towards the performance and the results, but the only way to do that is by preparation, and preparation eliminates fear. And once you've eliminated fear, you've got less anxiety. And then, of course, the more exposed they are to football, the more football that they watch, the more pictures that they are able to see and generate from the mind. Neuroscience has become one of the biggest contributors now in modern football, you know, and the ability for players to generate decisions and see pictures and make the best decisions. And of course, there's good decisions, but every decision in football can be a good decision. But there's the best decisions. And the best decisions are always based on the tactical principles and the culture that has been set out with regards to the overall schemes of the team. But you then also need the best players who have this dynamic superiority, as we call it. And this dynamic superiority is the player's ability to solve problems on the pitch without too much intervention from the coaches. That comes with a lot of other aspects, which also involve not just the coaching at that level, but also youth coaching and the stages that players come through with regards to their formative stages. And again, the game belongs to the players, I always say. And when you have very good players, players are able not just to carry out tactical information, but also make adaptations and adjustments that are necessary to increase the performance levels. And once you can do that and minimize mistakes on the pitch, you've got a better chance to not just improve the performance, but to give yourselves the opportunities to win football games.
Talking about oppositions, while analyzing the opposition tactically, you prefer to watch at least their last five games and then look at the data to try and find ways to capitalize on the opposition team's lapses. During the process, how do you find a good blend between video analysis and data analysis? Also, while drawing the conclusions, how do you look to avoid any sort of bias?
Your questions are unbelievable, you know, and they are thought-provoking. The cognitive bias is a huge influence on modern football and modern society. And when you look at where we are with regards to leadership and the influence that we have from a social perspective, you then get to understand that it's not easy. You know, I for one, I'm not a coach that trusts my opinion a lot because I'm extremely biased as a coach. There are certain aspects with regards to football that I fall a little bit closer towards. But also at the same time, when I look at the space of saying to ourselves that modern society or modern football now allows more for more collaboration, more opinions, that allows you to make even more informed decisions. And then you've got the support of data that allows you to verify or validate what has been probably seen by the eye or maybe even missed by the eye. Because it's very easy to put on a football game and listen to the opinions of people. And because of the opinions of people, you are then channeled into finding exactly what people are speaking about in the football game. But why I then also prefer to watch 3, 4, 5 games and maybe even 6 matches per opponent. Of course, that is time consuming, but that's the level that we work at. You know, you got to try to find the details, find the patterns. And once then you are able to pick up certain patterns, you are then able to collaborate the patterns picked up from the naked eye with regards to what the data suggests. And as soon as you have that, it's a little bit more easier to present to the players something that's a little bit more objective, that they also have a strong sense in understanding that the information is the information that can help them to win football matches, because that's what players want to know. They want to know whether or not what we are saying, what we are doing every single day will help them to win football matches. And that becomes our biggest responsibility. And to try to eradicate these biases, the use of data analysts, and we are very fortunate we have some of the best analysts in South Africa that we work with at Mamelodi Sundowns, with Sbu Makitla, Mario Masha, Kulam, even Dale. We've got a very extensive analysis and performance department. But the same can be said about that department we had at Pirates. We built a very strong intel and a very strong department that was really a very good support structure for the performance of the team. And I strongly believe that it's got a huge scope in relation to contributing to the overall performance of the team.
Looking back, what do you think is the biggest challenge that you have ever faced in your coaching career?
I think the hardest part of my coaching career was when I took over from Milutin Sredojević. I mean, it was a Friday afternoon when I was told that the coach had resigned, and Saturday afternoon, 24 hours, not even, to be honest. We didn't even have a training session with the team. We couldn't prepare the group. And we went in to play a match against Highlands Park, which we then subsequently lost. And that for me was the most difficult, you know, when you understand that, one, you are handicapped in the sense that you were never a professional football player. You are black. You move in a space where you are extremely handicapped. But we take these things as lessons and part of our growth. And of course, that spell at Orlando Pirates as a head coach, being the first black head coach of Pirates, puts us in a situation where we only think about the lessons and the takeouts and allowing it to shape us into becoming not just better coaches, because that's what it's helped me with, but also to become a better human being. And I think that is the space that I find myself in at the moment, and it's because of the life lessons, not just the life lessons but the football lessons that I got from being at Orlando Pirates, and in a very difficult space. Still, you continue to run the race with this handicap or these handicaps, where the age is already a factor, the color of the skin is already a factor, and the fact that I was never a professional footballer that already is a factor, because of course a lot of former professionals and top professionals sometimes have the benefit of relying on their successes as football players to be able to assist them with regards to the performance of the team.
What do you feel are the pros and cons of being a head coach in South Africa?
Yeah, in South Africa, well, it creates the platform. It gives you the exposure, particularly with Mamelodi Sundowns, where we are as a club is we are a global brand and we are extremely competitive and highly ambitious club led by the president Dr. Patrice Motsepe and the Motsepe Foundation and the family. But also the demands that are set with performance and the drive in relation to making sure that we succeed not just on the African continent, but also to participate at the Club World Cup and go into a space of achieving great things in that space. That exposure allows us to open the doors of working in other high-profile spaces. That is the goal. The goal is to make sure that we work hard to move and to elevate our knowledge, elevate our growth, but also to be exposed to different levels of the game, because I always say to people that the elephant doesn't know that sharks exist, because the elephant is only on land. There's an underwater world that is very vast and extremely interesting and extensive. And if we're not exposed to different environments and we don't open ourselves to understanding where the game is going, we might find ourselves being stagnant and or even regressing. I always say that coaches have three responsibilities. One is to respect the game of the past, because the game of the past has its own lessons that you can take out. Two is to vigorously and extensively study the game of the present. And three is to anticipate the game of the future. But all those things cannot be done if you are not exposed to a global space of where the game is.
We have nearly come to the end of our podcast session today. Now, I have my final question for you. What advice would you give to the aspiring coaches in the world?
I think some of the things that have helped me is my authenticity. As much as I try to be the coach that I feel the team needs, I also still try to be as authentic and as honest as I possibly can. The work ethic also, I think for me, is of paramount importance. I think one of the most important character traits for coaches is the ability to work extremely hard, invest in the craft and study the game as much as possible, and maybe even try to anticipate the game in the direction that the game is taking. Be innovative, you know, be innovative, try and trust yourself, have confidence in your ideas and work in a way that allows you to live and create a legacy that will benefit and provide the shade for many others in the future.
So captains, that was all for today. We need to end our session here. Thank you, Mr. Rulani, for joining us today. And to all of our viewers, thank you for tuning in. You can also support us on Patreon. The link of our page will be given in the description box below. Until next time, it's a goodbye from Armband.